So I guess this series is called Meet the Astronomer, but as you can tell, I'm simply impersonating an astronomer. I'm actually a physicist pretending to be an astronomer. But the dividing line between physics and astronomy, especially if the kind of stuff I'm going to talk about today, is very porous. So people who work in cosmology consider themselves astronomers, some consider themselves physicists, and some of them, like me, can't really make up their minds, so they don't bother. What I want to talk about tonight is what the universe is made of. And I've been very privileged in my career to have lived through a near revolution in the science of cosmology. When I got started in this field, I wrote my first paper back in 1981 when I was about 10 years old or so. And back then, cosmology was kind of the laughing stock of science, because we really didn't know very much at all. The data was very, very poor, and people could speculate endlessly, and you could pretty much come up with any wacky idea you wanted and publish your paper, and it would be considered legitimate science. That has changed very rapidly, especially over the last two decades. And what I'm going to try to convince you of is that we've developed a very, very clear idea just since the mid-1990s, particularly of what the universe is made of. And the only unfortunate thing is that it's weirder than we could possibly have imagined. This was one of these cases where nobody ordered this thing on the menu, it just arrived. And so I want to tell you tonight about some of the ideas we have about what the components of the universe are, and then why we would actually believe that. So we believe that the universe, here's a little pie diagram of what the universe is made of. We think that about 5% of the universe's energy, or this tiny little pie slice, is made of the stuff that you and I are made of. So basically, protons, neutrons, and electrons, the stuff, that the thing that forms the atoms in our bodies. It forms stars, it forms gas. In fact, it forms pretty much everything we can see in the universe. But we think it only makes up about 5% of the total budget of the universe in terms of its energy. And then about 25% is in a mysterious kind of matter called dark matter. And I'll talk a little bit about what we know about dark matter and why we think there is dark matter. And then another 70% is even weirder form of energy called dark energy, which is behaves in an even more peculiar way than dark matter. Now, the question you're probably going to ask is, why would anyone believe this story? And in general, we don't believe things in physics that are, you know, unless we have observational evidence for them, and we're just as human as anybody else. We don't believe really bizarre things unless we have really, really good evidence for them. So I want to talk to you tonight about why we have evidence for dark matter and dark energy, why people actually believe this stuff, and what the properties of these things are, and maybe what our prospects are for possibly detecting dark matter and dark energy directly. So let me go back to the beginning of my field, which starts with this rather unhappy-looking gentleman who you've never heard of. His name was Vesto Slipher. The reason he's so unhappy is he really doesn't get much credit for his discoveries, but I'll tell you what he discovered. He was working at about the time of the beginning of World War I, which is exactly 100 years ago for us. He was working actually a little bit earlier than that, so around 1916 or so. And he was measuring the motions of distant galaxies. And so let me show you some distant galaxies. These are not what he could see through his telescope. We have these wonderful telescopes now. We can resolve these galaxies. We can see the little stars inside the galaxies. He had a much smaller telescope, and to him, these objects just looked like blurs in his telescope, and that's why back then people often referred to them as nebulae. So there's a famous book called The Realm of the Nebulae. That's because there was a controversy as to whether these things were actually clusters of stars like our own galaxy, or if they were just gas clouds. Now, he wasn't trying to resolve that. What he was trying to do was measure how fast these nebulae or these galaxies were moving relative to us, and he was using something called the Doppler effect. So I'm going to show you a picture of the Doppler effect. This is the Doppler effect. And what happens is if something is coming toward you and it's a wave, it gets scrunched up and gets switched to a shorter wavelength. And if something's moving away from you and gives off a wave, it gets stretched out. So the example people always use is a train whistle. If a train is coming toward you, the pitch goes up as it moves toward you because the waves are getting scrunched up, and then as it passes you and moves away from you, the pitch goes down. Now, all the people who invented physics were Europeans, and they have lots of trains in Europe, so I usually talk about police sirens instead. But you get the same effect. Anytime something moving toward you, the pitch goes up, and when it moves away from you, the pitch goes down. Now, the same thing happens with light. If I move away from you, the light coming off of me gets stretched out and turns red, and as I move toward you, I turn blue. Does everybody see me turning red and blue? Blue. Anybody can see that in the back? You can see that? Red. Blue. Well, obviously that failed. But why did it fail? How come we don't get to see me turning blue and red? I mean, it would be very entertaining if it happened, but why doesn't it happen? Why don't I get to turn colors? I mean, we can hear a train whistle do it, and you know, that's the Doppler effect. Why don't anybody want to venture a guess?
You're too slow.
I'm too slow, and that's what my kids say, too. It's... The thing about it, the speed of sound is actually not that high. So sound moves at, you know, maybe 750 miles an hour. When you're in a car, slightly exceeding the speed limit, say at 75 miles an hour, you're moving at 10% of the speed of sound. You're moving at Mach 0.1 in your car down the interstate. So many things that we have familiarity with, trains and cars, move at a substantial fraction of the speed of sound. I can't move at a substantial fraction of the speed of light unless I'm an astronomical object, which I am not. So, but the galaxies that Slipher was looking at were moving at a substantial fraction of the speed of light, and he was hoping to see this kind of random motion of galaxies, and then he would figure out how fast the Earth was moving relative to some average motion. And what happens so often in science is that you're looking for one thing, and you discover something completely different. And that's almost all the great discoveries get made that way. You think you're going to see one thing, and you get a big surprise. Slipher's big surprise, and here's my pathetic PowerPoint animation, was that almost all the galaxies were flying away from him. He thought they'd be moving around randomly, but he had a survey of about 41 galaxies, and all but five of them were moving away, and most of them were moving away with very, very high velocities. The ones moving toward him weren't moving very fast. So he had discovered, essentially, the expansion of the universe, but he doesn't get any credit for it. In fact, there's no telescope named after him, no observatories, nothing that I know of got named after him. And that's because everything got named after this guy, Edwin Hubble. So you've heard, how many people have heard of the Hubble Space Telescope? Okay, so he's a major guy. Not to be confused with the 1930s baseball pitcher. He was working shortly after Slipher, and the reason that he gets all the credit for the discovering the expansion of the universe is that he did the math. He measured not just how fast things were moving relative to us, but also how far away they were. Now, measuring the speed of something is pretty easy, and I say that as a theorist who never looks through a telescope and has hardly ever measured anything in his life. But for an astronomer, a real astronomer, it's actually fairly easy because Doppler shifts are easy to measure. But he was trying to measure not just how fast things were moving, but how far away they were, and maybe see if there was some kind of relation there. And it's hard to measure distances in astronomy. You can measure nearby distances from something called parallax. As I move back and forth in front of you, it looks to me like the people in the front row are moving relative to the people behind them. And you could do the same thing if you were up here moving back and forth. We can see that from the Earth, too. As the Earth moves around the Sun in a year, the nearby stars look like their position is shifting relative to the faraway stars because the angle that we're looking at them changes. But that only works for nearby objects. And he was trying to look at distant galaxies. The general way that you could do a problem like that is to try to figure out how bright the objects are, and then look at how bright they appear. Because if you know how bright something really is, and you know how bright it appears to you, you can work backwards to figure out how far away it had to be to look that bright. Now the problem is we don't know how bright things are, and his problem was kind of the same as if you were sitting at the end of a football field, and someone has some 40-watt light bulbs burning, and somebody has 100-watt light bulbs burning. They're all different brightnesses, and so you couldn't tell if a dim bulb was dim because it was far away from you and was intrinsically bright, or if it was dim because it was close up and it was only 40 watts. What you need is some way of figuring out the absolute brightness of distant objects, and he came up with a way called Cepheid variables. He discovered that there was a certain class of stars that pulsate, and the brighter ones pulsate slower, and the dimmer ones pulsate faster. So by looking at these variable stars in other galaxies, he could figure out how bright these objects were intrinsically, and then he could work backwards to figure out how far away they were. And when he did that, he immediately did the first thing any scientist does. He did a graph. He plotted the speed on one axis, and he plotted the distance on another axis. And this is actually his original graph from 1929. And he said, hey, see my data all over here? It's obviously a straight line. Now, if somebody turned this in a freshman physics lab, they probably wouldn't get a very good grade for it. Because it's not obviously a straight line. In fact, there's some people think he knew the answer he wanted to get ahead of time. I won't speculate on that. But, of course, as more and more information came in, it did look more and more and more like a straight line. So what this tells you is that the farther something is away, this is the distance in parsecs, and a parsec is about 3 million light years. So this is 3 million light years, and this is 6 million light years. And then over here is the speed in kilometers per second. I don't know why it just says kilometers, but it's kilometers per second. And so you can see that there's this straight line relationship. Why is that important? Because this is the only kind of law you can have if you have an expanding universe. If you could imagine that you're standing here looking at objects moving away from you, and if there's no preferred center to the universe, this is something we have to get around. We're not at the center of the universe. I mean, I know some of us think we are, but we're really not. So it looks to us like everything is moving away from us in all directions, but if I go to the next galaxy over, it still looks to me like everything is moving away. So there's no special place in the universe, and everybody sees themselves as the center of an expansion. And if everything is expanding in such a way that the expansion looks the same from any point, the only way to maintain that is to have the farther away objects moving faster. You see, this is how fast the angle at which this thing I'm showing here is how fast this thing's moving. Here there's a shallow angle. It's not moving as fast. To maintain this constant separation, the far away objects not only have to move faster, but their distance has to be exactly proportional to their separation. So basically, Hubble discovered this expansion, and he invented modern cosmology. And pretty much from about 1927 until the mid-60s, that was all there was in cosmology. The universe was expanding, and we were going to measure how fast it was expanding. And the reason that was interesting is that Hubble's work led to one obvious question, which is, what is the ultimate fate of the universe? Is it going to expand forever, or is it going to slow down and recollapse? And you could ask a similar question if you threw an apple on the Earth. You could throw it so hard that it would fly out of the atmosphere and never come back. Or if you threw it up a little slower, it would slowly stop and come back down. And the difference is whether it has enough kinetic energy to escape from the Earth's gravitational pull. Now, the universe works exactly the same way. The universe is expanding, and it would like, you know, it could, if it's expanding fast enough, if the kinetic energy is larger than the potential energy of gravity, it would just expand forever. But if there was more mass, it would slow down and recollapse. And so this led cosmologists to ask what was really becoming the central question in cosmology, which is, how much mass is out there? Because if there was a lot of mass, we would live in a universe that would expand and recollapse, but if there wasn't a lot of mass, it would just expand forever. And so cosmology for about 50 years was just asking this one question. How fast is the universe expanding, and are we gonna end up getting squished back in a big crunch, or are we going to die from the universe getting cold and empty? So you have your choice of fates. It turns out that neither of these was right, but this is again one of these weird things where the answer was totally unexpected. So cosmologists went out and to look for matter, and the first thing you can ask is how much matter is there? Do we see out there? Well, we see stars, we see hot gas, we can kind of look at all this stuff, and we can add up how much we see. It turns out that's not very much. And it's not even most of the ordinary matter out there, because there's matter out there that's cold. There's cold gas that doesn't light up. There's dust that's hard to see. The best way to figure out how much ordinary matter in the universe is in the universe, oddly enough, is to look back in the very, very early universe. Because elements get made in the early universe, And the amount of elements you make depends on how much mass there is. So most of the helium in the universe actually gets made in the early universe. Most of the elements in our body are made in stars. So we're made, people say we're made from stardust if you're a romantic. They get, you know, made in stars and kicked out, and then eventually they find their way to Earth and they produce us. But there's one element that gets made in the early universe, and that's helium. Now, before you go home and say that, you know, buy a helium balloon and say, look, I've got some helium left over from the Big Bang, that's actually not where our helium comes from. Where does our helium come from? Anybody know? From Texas. Our helium gets mined from underground deposits, and those underground deposits, what happens when you let go of a helium balloon? It floats away, and you never see it again, and your child starts to cry. I mean, we've all had that experience. Some of us have that experience many times. Because the helium just escapes from the Earth's atmosphere. So the only way that we have any helium left at all on the Earth is radioactive decay deep underground produces helium nuclei, and those get trapped in the state of Texas, and then we go and we dig it out and use it to fill helium balloons. So most of the helium in the universe comes from the Big Bang, but that's the helium that's in stars. If you look at stars, it looks like there's a universal abundance of about 25% helium and 75% hydrogen. It's left over from the Big Bang. And what's interesting is that you can predict how much helium should be produced in the Big Bang, and it goes up as the density of matter gets higher and higher because the nuclear reactions go faster and faster and faster, you get more helium. So by working backwards, we can use this process called primordial or Big Bang nucleosynthesis to figure out how much matter there is in the universe. And what it tells us is that ordinary matter, the kind of stuff we're made of, only makes up about 5% of what you need the universe to recollapse. So for many years, especially in the 1970s, cosmologists said, hey, we got this low density of matter, the universe is going to expand forever, the story is over. But of course, the story wasn't over, because there was more. And the first person who realized there was more was this gentleman, Fritz Zwicky. He was apparently quite a character. And since there are children present, I will not tell all the stories I could tell about him. But he was renowned for referring to his enemies as spherical jerks. He said, because they're a jerk no matter what angle you look at them from. And he actually used an earthier term, but I won't repeat it. He was renowned for coming up to new students at Caltech when they were feeling kind of embarrassed and unsure of themselves and saying, who are you? That's how he introduced himself. But he was also a brilliant astronomer. And in the 1930s, he was looking at clusters of galaxies. So let me show you a couple clusters of galaxies. These are beautiful objects. This is the Fornax cluster. This is the Hercules cluster. They're much better pictures now, you can see with the Hubble Space Telescope. The amazing thing about these things is that they're almost unimaginably big. You know, the galaxy itself, our galaxy, has billions of stars and is hundreds of thousands of light years across. These things contain hundreds and thousands of galaxies, and they're millions of light years across. So these little blobs you see there are not stars. These are individual galaxies clustering together. And he was looking at how fast the galaxies were moving around in there. And the reason he was doing that was that he could figure out how much matter there had to be to hold the galaxy cluster together. If there wasn't enough matter, the galaxies would just go flying apart because there wouldn't be enough gravity to hold them together. And what he discovered was that it didn't look like there was enough matter at all. If you looked at how fast these galaxies were moving, they should have just flown apart. So he said maybe there's something inside the cluster that we don't see called dark matter. And he postulated this in the 1930s, and it was promptly ignored and forgotten. Now, I don't know if that was because people thought he was a little bit crazy or because he was kind of a jerk. I won't speculate here. But he basically his discovery was forgotten until it was, of course, rediscovered decades later. And the person who really, I think, cemented the dark matter picture was this woman, Vera Rubin, who actually just died last Christmas. She was looking at the motion of objects orbiting the galaxy. And I'll give you a little demonstration here, if I can find my yo-yo. Now, my wife said, do not hit anybody with this. So I won't. But I'll stand back. So if I swing the yo-yo in a circle, and you've all done this, admit that you've done it. We've all done this. As you swing it, you can feel that it's pulling on you. It's pulling outward. And the faster you spin it, the more force it's exerting. And if I spun it fast enough, the thread would break, and it would in fact go flying out into the audience, and I would have lied to my wife. So I'm not going to do that. But what it shows you is that the faster something spins, the higher the force has to be to hold it in a circular direction. And the same thing is true of our galaxy. If you measure how fast things are orbiting around the galaxy, that tells you how much mass has to be in the middle to hold them in that orbit. And the faster they're spinning, the more mass there has to be. Now, what Vera Rubin did was actually look at how fast things were spinning as you move farther and farther and farther away from the center of the galaxy. And there's a prediction that Isaac Newton could have made, which is that the velocity has to fall off as you get farther and farther away from the center of the galaxy. And that's true of planets orbiting in the solar system. The outer planets orbit much more slowly than the inner planets. But what she saw was not, in fact, that she didn't see what Newton would have predicted, which is that the speed should go down at long distances. Instead, she saw that the speed leveled out. These things were moving way too fast for the galaxy to hold them in a circular orbit. So she postulated that there had to be something there, some extra force keeping them from flying apart. And of course, the simplest explanation of that, if you're a cosmologist, is that it's dark matter. There had to be dark matter in the galaxy to keep all the galaxy stuff orbiting the galaxy from flying away. So Vera Rubin postulated that every galaxy, here's a picture of our galaxy, was embedded in a ball of dark matter, a spherical ball of dark matter. And so an object orbiting way out here sees the gravity not just of the galaxy, but the much larger gravity of all that dark matter, and that's what allows it to orbit very, very rapidly. Ooh, that's really cool. It allows it to orbit really, really rapidly without flying away. And you can calculate how much dark matter there has to be in the universe. The galaxies don't give you the best estimate. It really is the clusters of galaxies. So we go back to Zwicky, the poor forgotten Fritz Zwicky, who actually wasn't forgotten because we're talking about him right now, but his work was forgotten for many years. And if you look at the galaxy clusters, they give you a really good estimate of how much dark matter there is. And what it suggests is that dark matter makes up about 25% of what we need to stop the universe from expanding and recollapse, and ordinary matter makes up only 5%. So there's five times as much dark matter in the universe as there is ordinary matter. Now, what is this stuff? Well, we're not sure. If you asked someone for their best guess, they would undoubtedly tell you that it's probably a massive, as yet undiscovered elementary particle. That is, we think it's a new particle out there we haven't actually produced yet in an accelerator that interacts only very weakly with ordinary matter. Now, when we say it interacts weakly, what I mean is it doesn't scatter off of ordinary matter or we would have detected it by now. It doesn't give off light or we would have seen it. So it's dark, and however it's going to interact with us, it doesn't interact very strongly. Another way of saying this is that we don't actually know what the dark matter is. But on the other hand, we're working on it, all right? I'll tell you what we're working on in a minute. Now, if you thought we were done, you were wrong, because we still have a half hour of the talk. So what else is out there? Well, this picture of a world which was ordinary matter and dark matter was well established in cosmology throughout the 1990s, and it was kind of the picture I grew up with. And when I started teaching cosmology in the early 1990s, it's what I taught everybody. But there were some observers who were looking at the expansion of the universe to try to understand better what its final fate was. So instead of actually trying to measure how much matter there was and using that to figure out whether it would expand forever or recollapse, what they were trying to do was actually map out the expansion at very early times. So let me show you a picture. These are pictures of different possible fates for the universe. This is a universe that's so dense that it expands and expands and expands. We're right here. and then it stops expanding and it collapses back down again in 25 billion years. Here's a universe that's just exactly balanced between expansion and recollapse. It goes up, it goes up, it goes up, and it just barely keeps decelerating all the way out forever and ever. And then a universe that doesn't have enough matter to even be close to recollapsing expands for a while, and then it just, its velocity becomes a constant. It just keeps moving straight out. Now, if we could look into the future, we could just see which of these is our final fate, and that would be the end of the story. We can't look into the future, but what we can do is look into the past. The way that we look into the past is taking advantage of the fact that light doesn't travel infinitely fast. It travels at some velocity. So if you look at the sky, the night sky, you're seeing something which never really existed, because you're seeing light from that star that left 500 years ago, because it's 500 light years away, and that one is 10 light years away, so that light left 10 years ago, and that one is maybe, you know, 30 light years away, so it's 30 years old. You're not looking at the sky the way it is now. You're looking at the stars the way they were when the light left them, and the light left them at all different times. So our view of the sky is really this kind of mishmash of different times. What we'd like to do is look back and see what the early universe looked like, where these curves are kind of separate. Because if we could look at the early universe, we could figure out which of these curves we were on and extrapolate it into the future. And the way we do that is to find something that's so far away that it's we can see back an appreciable fraction of the age of the universe. So the universe is about 14 billion years old. So we would like to look back about a billion years. We have to look out about a billion light years, and that's very difficult. Two different groups, one led by Sol Perlmutter at out on the West Coast, and then the East Coast group, Bob Kirshner and I can't remember the other guy's name, but come to me in a minute, basically redid Hubble's original experiment, but they looked at the expansion rate very, very, very far away, very far into the distant past. And they did this by using another kind of standard candle, another kind of object where you knew how bright it was, called a type 1a supernova. So these are the brightest kinds of supernova, and supernovae are the brightest objects in the universe. They briefly flare up and are as brighter than the galaxies that they live in. And what these guys realized is that there was a relation between how fast the thing got bright and got dim and how bright it got. So they used these distant supernovae to measure how far away these distant objects were, and they could measure how fast they were moving, and then they could trace out the which path we were on. And what they discovered was something rather surprising. They discovered we weren't on any of these three curves. We were on the orange curve, in which the universe slows down, and then it suddenly starts to speed up and accelerate. So it's almost as if we go back to the apple example, it's almost as though I threw an apple into the air, and as I expected, it gradually slowed down. It looked like it was going to come back down, and oops, suddenly it accelerated out of the Earth's atmosphere like someone shot it out of a gun. This is a very, very unexpected discovery. It was around 1998 was when the discovery was made, and the fact that two different groups saw it independently meant that it was a credible discovery, and it instantly revolutionized cosmology. Because it told us our picture of cosmology was in fact wrong, that we didn't have just dark matter and ordinary matter. We had to have another component, which is called dark energy. And the main thing about dark energy is that it exerts repulsive gravity. So, you know, we're used to the idea that gravity is just an attractive force and, you know, it always pulls things together. And that's true in our everyday life. But dark energy has the property that it repels instead of attracting, and it actually pushes everything in the universe apart at late times and makes the universe accelerate. Now, one version of this is called a cosmological constant, and Einstein was so smart he invented all this stuff before we even knew it existed. He actually came up with the idea of a cosmological constant, but for totally wrong reasons. He invented it to make the universe not expand or contract, because they believed back then the universe was static, it just sat there. And then later, when it was discovered the universe was expanding, he was deeply annoyed by this because he could have predicted the universe was expanding and he would have been even more insanely famous than he already was. And so he said, well, the cosmological constant was my greatest blunder. But now we know that his greatest blunder was saying that the cosmological constant was his greatest blunder, because it turned out there is a cosmological constant. It's just not the kind he thought about. Now, the dark energy has to have very weird properties. One property that it has is that it doesn't get more dilute as the universe expands. So you can imagine, you know, the universe, the galaxies in the universe are kind of like little gas molecules in a box, and as the universe expands, the galaxies get farther and farther away from each other, and the density goes down. Same thing with all the gas in the universe. As the universe expands, the average density of gas in the universe goes down. But as the universe expands, the density of this stuff stays the same. It's almost like someone's putting in extra energy to keep the density the same. I mean, if that doesn't bother you, I haven't explained it well enough. But that's a very disturbing thing. It has negative pressure, which is why it exerts negative repulsive gravity. It doesn't cluster at all. So dark matter at least obeys the laws of gravity and clusters in spheres around galaxies. And we at least, you know, have that intuition. This stuff seems to just be uniformly distributed throughout space and has no ability to cluster at all. And we think it probably only feels the force of gravity. So that leads us now to our back to our pie chart, which again is this weird setup where most of the matter in the universe is not in the form of ordinary matter. It's in the form of either dark matter, which clusters around galaxies and galaxy clusters, and then the dark energy, which makes up 70% of the energy in the universe and is driving the universe to accelerate. Now, even after all of this evidence came in the 90s, people were still somewhat skeptical, and I think rightly so, because, you know, there's a famous statement, extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. At this point, the evidence was pretty good, but it wasn't extraordinary. But what really sealed the deal were some completely different observations made around 2003 with this satellite called the WMAP satellite. It was launched a few years before, and it's named after Wilkinson, who sadly missed out on two different Nobel Prizes, I think. He was scooped when they discovered the cosmic microwave background in the 60s at the very beginning of his career, and then he was part of this collaboration and died before they published the results, so they named the satellite after him. But if they give a Nobel Prize for it, of course he won't get one. What the WMAP satellite was looking at was the radiation left over from the Big Bang. So space is filled with this microwave radiation that was discovered in the 1960s at Bell Labs and is basically left over from the early stages of the Big Bang. Back when people actually had television sets that were not hooked to the cable, you could actually turn a TV set on and see the static, and a good fraction of the static you saw was actually the microwave radiation left over from the Big Bang. If you do a picture of what it looks like in space, if you could see with microwave eyes, you wouldn't see anything because the Earth's atmosphere blocks most of this stuff. But if you could get up above the Earth's atmosphere and see with microwave eyes and subtract off some backgrounds that we won't talk about, this is what the sky would look like. So this is a beautiful picture. This is the WMAP picture. Now, there's satellites since then that have gotten much better, but there's hot spots and cold spots. And so the temperature is not totally uniform. These are little fluctuations of about one part in a million. And they're left over from the early universe, and they're left over from the process that gave us galaxies. We think what happened in the early universe is that there were little fluctuations in the density, and these grew under the action of gravity. And as they grew, they imprinted themselves on the radiation. So when we measure it now with these satellites, we see these little hot and cold spots. And the nice thing is that the pattern of hot and cold spots depends on how much matter of different kinds there is in the universe. If there's a lot of ordinary matter or dark energy, that changes the pattern. And so what these guys do is they work backwards and say, okay, how much dark matter do I need to get this particular pattern? How much dark energy do I need? And they come up with another pie chart, completely independent of the one I showed you, and it looks exactly the same. So the WMAP people basically confirmed this rather bizarre picture brilliantly. So that brings us up to the present day. What do we do now? Because we think that the universe has this bizarre dark matter component. We think it has this bizarre dark energy component. Is there any hope to actually pin this stuff down and make it a little more real than just a pie chart? Well, there's a lot of efforts going on now to look for dark matter. And it's really kind of a three-pronged effort. The first prong is the Large Hadron Collider, which is here. So this is the world's largest particle accelerator. It's going to always be the world's largest particle accelerator because we'll never get enough money to build the next bigger one. These things, you know, since the 19th World War II, they've been building bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger accelerators. There used to be four or five of them operating in the world at any given time, but they're so huge now that the whole world can only afford one, and that's it. But it's probing particle physics at the highest energies we can realize on the Earth, and the goal is to, if you were lucky, or, you know, if physics worked this way, to actually produce the dark matter particle in the accelerator. Now, that's only going to work if it has a mass that's low enough that you could actually make it, and so far we haven't seen it. So it hasn't been discovered at the Large Hadron Collider. Now, they're analyzing their latest batch of data now, and we'll see what happens. It would be great to make it in an accelerator because it would be like pinning a butterfly to a wall. You could capture it, you could study all of its properties, you could really pin it to the ground, but this may not work. The second batch of experiments are for people who like to be underground. If you don't like the sun too much. These are what are called direct searches for dark matter, and they all basically take place in abandoned mine shafts or big underground tunnels. And the idea is you go down deep, 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 deep underground. There's one in the Grand Sasso tunnel in Europe. There are several in abandoned mines. Well, I don't know if they're abandoned mines, but they're mines in the United States. And the idea is you go down and you get a big vat of stuff. Now, the stuff you use depends on what, you know, you're trying to do, but lately people have settled on liquid xenon because it's comparatively cheap and easy to get in mass quantities. So there's an experiment called xenon 100, which is 100 kilograms of xenon, and then they're going to do xenon 1 ton, which is a ton of xenon. You put it in a big vat, you sink it way underground, and the reason you go underground is because you want to get away from all the cosmic rays that are zapping us on the surface of the Earth. You're trying to get rid of all the background. And then you wait for a dark matter particle to come flying through the universe and go ding, and hit one of your nuclei, and the nuclei goes flying this way, and the electron goes flying that way, and you detect it on your detector, and you win the Nobel Prize. Okay, that's the theory. Now, in practice, the big problem with these detectors is they actually see a bunch of stuff. It's called background, you know, things that aren't at all due to dark matter. So the idea is to understand exactly what the background ought to be, and then if you see a signal a little bit above the background, you know that it's dark matter. And then you immediately build an experiment 10 times bigger, and the signal ought to jump out at you like an elephant from your data. Again, these things haven't seen anything yet. In fact, they're starting to exclude regions of space that we think we ought to see the dark matter in. I would put, if we do discover the dark matter in the next decade, I would put my money on these experiments. I think they're optimized to see dark matter. They're exploring in a regime where we think the dark matter mass is likely to be. And I think that, you know, it would be very, very not implausible if they detected something in the next decade. A third way to find dark matter is to look at what it does out in space. And so people think that if there's dark matter in the center of the galaxy, it can annihilate with other dark matter and make high-energy gamma rays or X-rays, and we could see them with something like this telescope. This particular mode of detecting dark matter has been way too successful. People are constantly seeing these background radiations and saying, we found dark matter, or you guys found dark matter, and I'm going to write the paper on it now. There's lots of astrophysical backgrounds that we don't understand. And so there's a lot of kind of outstanding signals out there that could be due to dark matter annihilation, but are more likely due to some kind of weird astrophysical process that we just haven't figured out yet. So this might be a way of finding dark matter, but it also might be a way of finding other astronomical phenomena that have nothing at all to do with dark matter. These are not well-controlled experiments in the sense that you're not getting they're not designed just to look for dark matter. They're designed to look for radiation, and it's up to you to kind of interpret it correctly. So that's kind of where we stand with the dark matter search. We've got these different probes. No one has actually seen anything yet, but we're hopeful. I would say, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if we found dark matter in the next decade, but I also wouldn't be surprised if we didn't find it in the next decade. It's kind of a 50-50 shot. Dark energy is much more difficult. And the problem is that dark energy, we don't think there's any way of detecting it directly. What we're trying to do is do the original measurement of the expansion of the universe and just do it better and better and better and better. And hopefully if we can map out exactly how well exactly how the universe is expanding, we can extrapolate backwards and try to figure out what the correct theory is of dark energy. So here, most of the effort has gone into just doing more of the same. So there's a thing called the Dark Energy Survey that's using various techniques, supernova surveys, but other astronomical techniques, basically to try to map out exactly how well exactly how the universe is expanding. And that those efforts, I think, are going to yield a lot of interesting information, even if we don't, you know, run to ground the actual dark energy component. I think they're going to tell us a lot about how the universe works, and they're definitely worth pursuing. So where do we stand at this point? Well, as I said at the beginning, I would argue that for the first time in cosmology, we know exactly what the universe is made of, and yet we don't. That is, we know that there are these weird components out there, and yet we don't really know fundamentally what they're made of. We just know how they behave. We can describe them, but we can't actually say very much about how they actually behave. Now, what do I do? I've spent most of my time over the last decade or so working on dark energy. About 70% of my work has been developing new theories for dark energy. For any theory, you can kind of predict how the universe evolves with time, and you can compare it with observation and say, that's a good theory or that's a bad theory. Now, we don't publish the bad theories, but I also have spent time trying to rule out other people's theories. You know, it's a game that, you know, you can either prove your own theories right or just prove everybody else's wrong. Both of them are legitimate forms of science. But I've also worked on a little modeling of dark matter, and I've always been interested in element production in the early universe. That's how I got my start when I published my first paper when I was 11 years old. And that's been a continuing sort of interesting research area for me, is trying to understand how the elements are formed in the early universe and what they tell you about the behavior of the early universe. So that's all I wanted to say. We have time for, I think, some questions, if anybody has any questions. Yeah.
How can you tell that they're moving in the length of time that humans have to measure them, and in which direction they're going?
Well, it's you can't. They're moving in three dimensions, so they're moving, you know, some angle relative to us. The sideways motion you can't see at all because it would take like a billion years. So what you do is you use the Doppler effect to see the radial motion, and then you assume that they're isotropic. They're moving the same in all directions. So if you know the radial velocity of a set of galaxies, you can extrapolate to get the sideways velocity. Now, with stars, you can. I mean, there are stars that you can measure the what's called the proper motion sideways, but that's because they're so much closer to us. But with these guys, it's the radial velocity or nothing. Yeah?
Bob, let me have our person asking the question hold the mic so we can get it on camera, if that's all right. So we'll pass the mic around.
Does the change of the seasons affect the Doppler effect? By that I mean, as the Earth orbits the Sun, sometimes we're going away from what we're looking at, sometimes we're going toward it.
Yeah, that's a good question. To the best of my knowledge, I just gave a question like this to my cosmology class, so I should know the answer. That's a small effect most of the time. Where it actually is interesting in my field is, and this is something I didn't talk about, but the Earth itself is moving through the dark matter of the galaxy. And so many years ago, a set of cosmologists pointed out that at one time of year, it's either June or December, the Earth's rotation is moving with the dark matter, and at another time it's moving against the dark matter, which means that you ought to see an increased signal in these dark matter detectors in June and a decrease in December, or the other way around. I can't remember which one it is. And there's a experiment in Italy that doesn't claim to have seen dark matter directly, but they claim they see this seasonal modulation. They claim that their detector rate goes up at the correct time of year and goes down at the opposite time of year. And this has been going on since the 1990s. Every other experiment in the world claims that they've ruled out this possibility, but these people keep seeing the effect, and it's a little bit weird. No one is quite sure what to make of it. The reason it's a little dangerous is that you can imagine a lot of other things varying on a yearly cycle, like, you know, the temperature, when the new postdocs come on. I mean, all these things also have a yearly cycle, and they may be what's causing the signal instead of the motion through the dark matter.
Do we have one in the back?
Yeah? Do we have...
Where? Hand up? Oh.
So when you do find out what dark matter is made of, or dark energy, whichever comes first, where do you even go from there? Like, what's next?
Well, that's a good question. You know, when they started out with the WMAP satellite, I knew one of the guys on that satellite, and he said, you know, Bob, we're gonna find out everything there is to know about cosmology, and then there won't be much more for you to do. And I said, well, what am I going to do? He said, well, you know, I don't know, because we're going to find out everything there is to know. Well, it turned out they didn't plan on the dark energy, which it remains a persistent mystery, and they still haven't gotten us any closer to the dark matter. I think that if we knew what the dark matter was made of and we knew what the dark energy was made of, that would solve kind of 90% of the unsolved problems in cosmology. But there still are other mysteries that I didn't really talk about. This whole idea of the element production in the early universe, it matches up pretty well with what we see, but there's one element, lithium, where it doesn't give the right prediction, and no one is sure why. And it might be that there's something weird going on in the early universe that we haven't discovered yet. So there's always mysteries in science. There's always a frontier, and the key is to be right at the frontier. You don't want to be way behind where nothing is interesting, but you don't want to go too far ahead where the, you know, the crazy people are. So you want to kind of sit in that middle area. Yeah.
I don't have a question, but I've got something that says about the dark matter and the ordinary matter.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody is just plain good, but nobody is just plain bad.
It's been my experience, too.
We're all shades of gray.
Mm-hmm. That's right. And, you know, there's dark matter going through you right now, we think. It just doesn't do much. It just goes right through you like you're not there. Or you go right through it like it's not there. I mean, it's a question of perspective, I guess. Okay.
We have a question here.
I've been wondering this for a while. Would antimatter be the same thing as dark matter? Because I know they both exert negative waves.
Well, antimatter, we think actually, I mean, there's been a long, long process of trying to understand if there's much antimatter in the universe. And it seems like, you know, you might think the most natural thing is that the universe ought to be like half antimatter and half matter. But it isn't, because if it were, they would have mostly annihilated each other. For whatever reason, and again, this is one of these mysteries we haven't resolved yet, there's a lot more matter in the universe than there is antimatter. So today, almost all the antimatter from the early universe has gone, and all we have is matter. And we don't really understand why that is. That's another unsolved problem.
If there are matter and antimatter, then is there a possibility that there's also anti-dark matter somewhere in the universe?
Yes. Well, in fact, that's another unknown. It's possible that the dark matter consists of equal amounts of dark matter particles and dark matter antiparticles. And if that's the case, we should be able to see them annihilating in the middle of the galaxy. So that's one of the things that these satellites are looking for. But there's also theories where, just like our matter, the anti-dark matter is much less abundant than the dark matter, and it just got annihilated away, and all we're left with is dark matter. And we're nowhere even close to figuring out which of those is the right theory, but people have discussed both possibilities.
Are there any theorists that think there's a connection between dark energy and dark matter? I know, you know, obviously there's not a lot of specific answers.
Yeah, I wrote a paper on it, so I'm one. It's at least one. It's a natural idea that we don't know, you know, we don't know what either one is, so what, maybe there are some two aspects of the same thing. It's surprisingly hard to make them work together. The other thing I didn't mention, and, you know, that could also blow all of this out of the water, is there's also a group of people who think that maybe this isn't a form of extra energy or matter. Maybe our theory of gravity is wrong. Because if you followed everything I talked about, every time I talked about some evidence, it was always gravity, right? The gravity, is it working in the galaxy, and it's not working in the clusters of galaxies, and it's not working in the universe as a whole. So it would be natural to think, well, maybe maybe it's not extra matter. Maybe we've got the theory of gravity wrong. But it's really, 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 really hard to mess around with the theory of relativity and get sensible results. I mean, Einstein really did a great job. And anybody who tries to mess with his theory usually gets burned. So it's hard to do. But yeah, that's a natural idea, and it's surprisingly hard to make it work well.
Who's next? Oh, I'm right here, so.
You were talking about the dark matter surrounding the solar system as in being kind of like a ball that we're all floating in. I was wondering if there's anything that has given, any data that's given you that shape? Or well, is there something?
That's a theoretical prediction that comes about because of what dark matter can't do. So, you know, the reason our galaxy is a disk is it started out as a sphere and then, you know, a spinning sphere, and it radiated energy. And as it radiated energy, gravity couldn't hold it up sideways. It was centrifugal force holding it like this, so it flattened out into a pancake. But we think the dark matter can't radiate energy, and any kind of gravitating matter that can't radiate energy naturally ends up in a kind of spherical shape. It's just a natural endpoint for gravitational evolution. We haven't measured it directly because we can't see it that well. But that's there are other theories that maybe maybe it could be more disk-like. But the kind of vanilla theory is that it's a sphere.
Did I see you? Okay.
So mine's a bit more philosophical in nature. If you take that the average human lifespan is roughly 80 years, why even study cosmology? Why? What personally for you is your draw? And then
well,
also for the
I still have three kids I got to send through college. Oh, you want a different answer? All right. Well, I think it's interesting to understand what the nature of the universe is. It's not just cosmology. I mean, it's true of all of physics and all of chemistry and all of biology. We want to understand the way the world works. I consider myself very lucky that someone's actually willing to pay me to do that because I think everybody's naturally curious and we'd like to understand how things work. So even if, I think predicting the distant future of the universe, which I've also kind of played around with, is a little bit silly because we're never going to be there to see it, and it's hard to prove that our speculations are right. But I think just coming to grips with understanding the way the universe works has been a universal human impulse since the ancient times.
So I know you touched on the idea that like the theory of gravity could be wrong, and that's intriguing to me. So when you say that, like, because you're getting way out in left field at this point, I'd imagine, due to just the difficulty of proving relativity wrong, right? Like, when you say that, like, what kind of speculations is it? Like, was dark energy pushing us down versus gravity pulling us down? Like, what kind of crazy theories are there
based
on that?
Well, so the basic idea, so our standard theory of gravity is actually Einstein's theory of relativity. And his theory predicts that it's really just, you could write it down in one equation. It's just that the one equation expands out into 10 differential equations that are all coupled to each other that no one can solve except on a computer. So on the right-hand side of the equation, there's matter and energy and what's called the stress-energy tensor. It's all the different forms of energy that there can be. And on the left side, there's something called the curvature tensor, which predicts how space is curved. And then in Einstein's theory, matter just curves space, and then objects follow the curved space. So the planets orbiting the sun, they think they're moving in a straight line. They're just following the curvature of space around the sun. So when you mess around with Einstein's theory, what you're generally doing is modifying the curvature part. I mean, what I've talked about today is modifying the energy part, adding extra kinds of energy. But you could say, well, maybe the curvature is related to the matter in some other way. Maybe there's an extra curvature term on this side or an extra way that the curvature is calculated. And it just is, the problem is it's very hard to modify relativity to get what you want without then suddenly predicting that the orbits of the planets are totally not like what we see.
Right, because the dark energy is pushing, because it's negative, right? So it's pushing the galaxy apart?
Well, the problem is really it's a more general problem, which is that relativity works really, really, really well on the scale of the solar system, and it's hard to make a new change to it that only is going to work out here, but it's not going to have any effect in here. That's the practical problem.
We're out of time, but I'm sure Dr. Scherrer would stay for a couple minutes and answer more questions.
Sure,
And let's give him a big round of applause. If you'd like to go upstairs and see Orion through the Seyfert telescope, you're welcome to go.